evening, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening, board.
Be free to leave.
I'd like to welcome you all to the workshop meeting of the Exeter Township School Board. This is one of two meetings we hold each month. This evening, we will semi-formally discuss issues that face the board, which will be voted on next week. I would like to announce that we did have an executive session prior to this meeting to consider some personnel issues. I'm going to vary the itinerary a little this week. We normally have public comments prior to us doing any business. Considering that most of you are probably here to discuss the antique of Exeter issue, we will hold public comment until after we do the rest of the business, and then we'll open it up to y'all. So that said, we will begin. Well, board, we discussed about a month ago creating a compensation, an executive compensation committee. Mr. Chappell will be heading out, Mr. Staub and Dr. Bender have both volunteered to serve on that committee. So since the board approves all committee assignments in December, that will be brought forward as a issue next week in the voting meeting. We also have two sets of minutes from March 11th and March 18th. Does anyone have any comments they'd like to make on those minutes at this time? We'll naturally have the opportunity next week to make any revisions you might find necessary. There are two board policies that will be considered. Policy 01 is strictly changing the address from the old Brighton site over to Elm Street. The second policy, 113.5, parental status and appointment of surrogate parents. Does the administration have anyone that could talk on that?
Our special ed attorney has informed us that we need this policy to cover children with disabilities who may have a surrogate parent acting on their behalf. And apparently when we have our review in our special ed department, which will probably be a couple years from now, I think, because I believe we had one a year or so ago, this will be one of the things that they look for. So this policy was, the wording and so forth, was developed in consultation with our special ed attorney, and we'd like to put it in place this year so that we have it for the future.
Any questions?
Mr. President, I'd like to go back to name and classification. I didn't get to ask something about this. Where it says on the purpose, I would hope that we could insert, instead of the Commonwealth, rather, I think we should have who live within the municipal boundaries of the Exeter Township in St. Lawrence Borough. We are not obligated to provide education for everyone in the Commonwealth. If that is the state's function, we are only obligated to do what is here in our district. So I'd like to.
The reference on that is the Constitution, and indeed the Constitution forms the various boards at this level to service the needs of the students of the Commonwealth, since it is a specific delegation of authority from the legislature.
Well, I have the Constitution here in front of me, and Article 4, or Article 3, Number 14, it says, "The General Assembly shall provide for the maintenance and support of a thorough and efficient system of public education to serve the needs of the Commonwealth." That is their job, it's not our job.
And they have delegated authority to local boards, as I said, an email that you may not have seen, that we, these boards are formed as an arm of the legislature.
I understand that.
Therefore, we work under their rules, and this is the appropriate phraseology on that.
Well, I disagree.
Not new. Any other comments? Business functions, Mr. Stone.
Under letter A, it's attachment 6A. We'll be voting on approving the audit services of Rines and Kuntz Lesher for the Exeter Township tax collector for the period 2013 through 2015. The fee to perform this is $4,200 a year, which is shared equally between the school district and the Township of Exeter. And the fee represents an annual increase of $100 per year.
Any questions, comments?
Under letter B, we will be voting on approving a service agreement with CSI for the support of the Owatsu Telethon and Rollin Intercom Clock System for all of our district buildings for the period of June 1st through 2014 through May 31st, 2015, at a cost of $19,584. That is the same cost that we have had since 2009. This represents a full service agreement for the equipment, phones, intercom, voicemail, clock system. So it's just, it's not anything hourly, it's whatever it takes for them to get the job done. Under letter C, just reporting that the Department of Education has approved PlanCon Part K. It's project refinancing, the issuance of the general obligation bond series of 2014 to advance refund a portion of the general obligation bond series A of 2009, series C of 2009, series of 2010, and fund capital projects. The temporary reimbursement rate is 11.48%, and that's in attachment 6C. I don't understand much of this either, so I'll explain that what we're gonna get back is about $865,000 from the state that will come back to us for part of our borrowing. That is their support of ours for the borrowing of these bonds. So that's just reporting that we are going to receive $865,000, and that is over a period of 14 years. Any questions? Under letter D, we're going to be voting on authorizing the district superintendent to execute an alternative education program agreement with Antietam School District, which will be in effect until June 30th, 2014. The alternative education services are for an Exeter Township School District student at a rate of $55 per day. All this is a student that moved into our district, but because of their situation, what we are doing is we are reimbursing them as they're gonna, that student's gonna finish out their education this year. So it is our financial responsibility. And lastly, in letter E, it's an attachment 6E. We'll be approving budget transfers for the month of March 2014 in the amount of $17,864. That's it.
Any questions for Mr. Stahl in those issues? Thank you, Jim. Dr. Bender, personnel.
Under personnel, next week we'll be voting on Part A, one retirement, Part B, two resignations, and Part C, we have several appointments under certificated staff, substitute teachers, support staff, and extracurricular staff. Any comments on A, B, or C? And the other item we'll be voting on next week is Part D, approval of staff conferences, and we have 12 listed on the agenda. Any comments on attendance at professional conferences? That concludes personnel.
Thank you, Dr. Bender. Student functions, Mrs. Cutler.
Thank you. Students functions, item A, reporting the field trips within the 60-mile radius that have been approved. These do not require board approval, they're just reported. Items 1 through 17. Item B, we'll be moving the following field trip, which is beyond the 60-mile radius, to be approved next week. The senior yearbook high school staff are going to Belcourt Publishing to select the cover for their yearbook.
I have a question on the...
Sure.
I'm wondering why students would take a day of school off to select the cover for a yearbook. With all the technology we have, why they wouldn't be able to go to a website and pick a cover.
Thank you. I know they've done that every year. I did ask the same question, and it's an experience that, you know, they get to experience the publishing company and the process and so forth. And I think that was part of what I was told. If you need a more thorough answer, Dave, I could get it to you. So I know I'm not giving you the best answer, but it's more than just actually picking the cover. They actually go through a process at that company where they get to experience a publishing process.
Item C, we will move this to next week's agenda to approve the request of Emily Holloman, the elementary instrumental music teacher, to conduct research examining the practice sessions of her students as part of her graduate course required at Westchester. Any comment? Item D will also be moved to the voting meeting to approve the request of John White, senior high art teacher, to use work in surveys of his students as part of his master's requirement at Kutztown. Item E, moving that the Board of Directors approve the amendment to the agreement between Invo Healthcare Associates and the Exeter Township School District to increase the number of speech and language pathology services provided for 40 hours per week to 60 hours per week. And you have a set of minutes in your folder as well. And that's it.
Item C and D, where the teachers will be using the students' work. You've got all the clearances and everything you just said for the authorizations?
Yes.
Parents will sign off. Mr. Deasinger, curricula.
It would be recommended that the Board of School Directors award a credit weight of 1.1 to all students who successfully complete any advanced placement course in accordance with the standards set by the school district.
Can we define what successfully complete means?
I'm sorry, Dave, say again.
I'm
watching
to define
successfully
complete.
Successfully
Successfully complete means they earn a class credit through the Exeter Township School District. They pass the course with whatever parameters are set by the teachers, the tests and quizzes and other assessments that are used to evaluate the student. And they get a satisfactory report card grade that allows them to pass the course.
Obviously, an issue here is there is currently a requirement for the advanced placement courses to get the 1.1 you need to take. We don't even have the results of the College Board's AP test, whoever puts it out. And the question that has arisen is, are we requiring the people to take that paid-for test inappropriately, and should we be giving our own final exam and giving that credit weight of 1.1 based upon successfully completing our course, not just taking the AP test? Ms. Kutcher, I know, has a comment on that.
Right, and I'll read my statement so that it will be clear. We talk about rigor in our programs, and further we search for a method to evaluate rigor. The AP program has offered school districts a credible package that meet this goal. Our teachers get professional development through the College Board. Our curriculum is aligned with the expectations of the College Board, and the AP exam validates our students' performance in our class. That's the package. There are no do-overs, extra credit, or opportunities for cheating. After a decade of effort, are we good? Let me tell you this. On November 18th, 2013, we received a letter of recognition from the College Board, and I want to share this excerpt. We would like to congratulate your school district for earning a place on the AP District Honor Roll. A total of 477 school districts from the United States and Canada are being honored by the College Board with this placement on the 4th Annual AP District Honor Roll. These districts were selected for simultaneously increasing access to advanced placement coursework while increasing the percentage of students earning scores of 3 or higher on the exams. The AP scores are nationally recognized by colleges and universities and can be applied to either one's elective credits or a specific course credit which allows students to advance to the next level. Some students from K-12 schools offering multiple courses can receive the equivalent of one semester of college credit, thus reducing the cost of their education. It seems fair that for the purpose of class rank, taking an AP class would count for something above and beyond giving the course an honors designation with its associated 0.05 bump. But what if students do not take the AP exam itself? Should students be qualified to get a 1.1 bump if they don't take the exam? Choosing not to take the AP exam demonstrates at best a fear of being unable to master the course material, or at worst, a lack of commitment to master the material. The demonstrable success of our students to do well on the exam should counter the fear. That can only occur, however, if everyone takes the AP test and all do well, as they should if the students apply themselves appropriately. On the other hand, a student's lack of commitment to actually test oneself against an established standard should be reflected in the district's policy in determining class rank. I challenge you to say you would hold an athlete in the highest esteem that decided not to compete in a county or state final because of fear of failure or lack of desire to prepare appropriately for the competition. Class rank has occasional value for some scholarship eligibility, but that is of secondary importance. Our goal should be to reward students who embrace the challenge of competing at a national level. After all, is that not one of the values we want our students to take away from this program? As for the $89 to take the exam, generally colleges give 3 credits for an AP score. 3 credits at Penn State costs about $1,500, and at private colleges can cost up to $3,000. All considerations aside, it seems to me to be a pretty good return on investment for anyone taking an AP class. Something for us to think about.
Carol, I agree with your comments, and I had asked the superintendent, what would be the score that a student would get at 1.1? And I think, Dr. Morrow, you said 60?
That's the score, that's the course, she had to have an average of 60 for a year as a course.
Well, but 60, isn't that like a D minus or something?
I guess so, but our kids in the D classes very, very rarely get anything less than D.
Well, then I think...
But yeah, that's the lowest, the average passing course.
Well, I would think that we want our students to do rigorous work. We've talked about that many times, and I do not think that 60 would look like a rigorous work ethic, and a 1.1 would not be acceptable. And I do agree with Carol that the 1.1 should be for those that take the exam and prove that they are qualified when they go to college to then be able to have that credit toward college. We do not want to lower standards so that more people can get into the course. We want to make sure that all the people that have been in the course, you know, are doing what they're supposed to do and getting out of it what they're supposed to get out of it. So I would ask that we, right now you have to have the 1.1 you have to take the exam to have the 1.1. I would hope that we can do that, and I think there was a problem maybe with how we told people if they don't have the resources, the financial resources, that, you know, there is available money for them to take the course at the district's expense. So that's my position on it, and I would be looking that way to keep things as well.
I'm going to support the switch to 1.1. Personally, I feel it's significantly more important for the student to complete the class. You're talking about four and a half months in the AP class. Bev, just to confirm, it is 1.05 for an honors class. Is that correct?
Correct.
So right now, what we have is we have a weighted grade for an honors class of 1.05. But yet, if you go one step further and take an AP class, it's 1.05, unless you take a test. Well, I don't know about you, I'm more concerned about what you've done in that 4.5 months in that classroom, whether or not you went and took that test. Now, the individuals that are taking the test, I still recommend it. It's a tremendous bargain. You're able to take these credits, take these classes and get college credits, I believe, at most of the state schools. So we are not saying don't take the test. We have students who are taking the test, and the children that are in these AP classes, for the most part, we're not worrying about them getting 60s. If they were getting 60s, we wouldn't be receiving awards for the grades they received on those AP tests. What I think we need to do is reward the students for the time they spend in the class, not whether they went through the exercise of taking a 2-hour test on a Saturday morning.
Question for you, Dr. Martin. What is the qualification to enter an AP course?
To be admitted into the class?
Yes.
I think it depends on each course, and I don't have the soaring eagle with me, so I have to refer to each course. It depends.
So it could be possibly based upon recommendation of previous instructors, as long as
oftentimes it's past performance in that same discipline, be it math or English or science or social studies or music or whatever, and the recommendation of a teacher, and having in some cases there are, you know, prerequisite courses that need to have been successfully completed.
Tomorrow.
wasn't going to say anything because I didn't want to stand between you folks and the discussion on the merger, but the truth is that I am the proponent of this particular recommendation. I think sometimes when policies are initiated, no matter how well-intentioned, there can be negative unintended consequences. In this particular case, the way that Exeter works, if you take a regular class and get an A, you get a 4.0. If you do an honors course, it's multiplied by 1.05. If you take an AP course, it's multiplied 1.1. But we actually added a stipulation that I felt was somewhat, and I'll use the term, economically discriminating. What happens is we then require the student to go out on his or her own dollar with his or her own transportation to take an exam. What I felt particularly disturbing about this was that that student, of course, in addition to paying for this AP course and any other AP course, along with the SAT and the ACT, takes the AP exam. And it's by taking that exam that you get the 1.1 multiplier. The school district doesn't get any reports of that exam back. So it's, a student can get a 1, student can get a 5. I just felt that adding this unnecessary economic burden on the student above and beyond everything that he or she has to deal with is just economically not justified.
I would refer you to the Wilson website and the Wyomissing website to take a look at their criteria, which is far more stringent than ours. And it's not that we have to be like them, but they are in our community and they manage to do it.
And again, my only concern is as long as there are scholarships in place and the test is accessible to all of our students, I can support that also.
Any other comments? Hearing none. It will be carried forward to the voting meeting next week. Are there any other items that the board would like to generate for consideration? The discussion agenda, the Exeter Township merger discussion. I'm looking first for any comments or questions or whatever from the board members.
I'd like to voice it, my opinion and share. I just share my opinion. Last Wednesday evening, I did not say a word. I felt that it was the community's opportunity to speak, so I didn't say anything. Last year, when the initial report came out, I was on the record and said that I was concerned from a financial standpoint, that there were a couple items immediately that came to light that were concerned. One being the contract and one being the millage that we would have had to overcome regardless. And I think I also made the comment at that particular time that the only way you can make a merger work financially is to shutter buildings and furlough people. And that really is the way that most mergers work to make it make financial sense. However, this is not a business. I am concerned, there's other things I look at, I view it, that this should be looked at as a cost-benefit analysis. What is the cost to the student? What is the cost to the taxpayer? And then what are the benefits? I did jot down some notes. The potential costs, obviously, are in contracts, in millage loss. We have to deal with the support, their support staff that is not unionized. Obviously, the time frame involved, There is a concern for me from a facility standpoint. I don't know the buildings that well. I do know ours, so that does, I have a little bit of a concern there. I have a significant concern about the potential disruption to our students, moving from different schools, shutting one of our schools down. I have a community concern about job losses. I feel that if we need to take care of ours individually, if we have a retirement and we choose not to fill that retirement, we do that based on the fact that the students don't need that particular teacher because our enrollment has dropped a little bit. And then the other area that really does concern me is future funding uncertainty. So when you have a future funding uncertainty, is that the time to take on a major undertaking? My personal opinion is it is not. However, I was in full agreement of looking at merger options, looking at discussions. I think it is the board's responsibility to take a look at this to see if it does make sense. It's no different than when we looked at the bus, the transportation study. I think it's no different than that. I personally cannot support this right now. However, I do support as many shared services that we possibly can have. These are our neighbors, the children, they're commingled through the community. We play ball together. And I think that's something that we can look at without totally upsetting the apple cart. There has been an unbelievable amount of angst and acrimony out there. Please understand that you received the information the same time that we did. So we've been flooded with emails and things like that, which is great. We appreciate the community involvement. However, this is the first time that the board has had an official opportunity to speak after seeing this information. So for the folks that kind of went, I think, a little bit over the top, please understand this is our first opportunity to speak. So if it does come to a vote, I will not support it. But I still get... But again, I still think it is our responsibility to review the options, and I still think there are things that we can do with shared services with the Antietam School District. Yeah.
Thank you. Anyone else?
I just want to say that I thank you all for coming here tonight, and I thank you so much for your communication to me and to the rest of the board members. I have listened very seriously to all your concerns, and I do believe that the power is in the people, and I do not think that any merger could go through without the full support of the community. And I cannot see that now, and I will stand with the people, and I will not support it.
I'd like to preface my remarks tonight by saying I'm not committed one way or the other at this present time. I'm still not convinced of the right way to decide. 2 weeks ago, we all heard the report. That report was requested by the board of both districts so that we could have more information to make a decision. I never envisioned that that report, though, would be the final step. The report had several assumptions that we can investigate, and let me address some of those in terms of the concerns that we've heard from the community. The report addressed the overcapacity that the districts would have if we merged, and the assumption was made that Jackson Wall would be closed. And looking at the buildings, I think that was just one assumption. It wasn't a bad assumption, but I think another approach could be that Jackson Wall would stay open and the elementary center in Antietam would be closed. Thinking through that, that would mean that two schools would be closed in Antietam, and the only school that would remain would be the what is currently the 7th through 12th grade secondary building. The reason I mention this is that by keeping Jackson Wall open, it would maintain the integrity and structure of the current Exeter School District and would merely add one more building onto the facilities we have now. There were concerns that Jacksonville would close. Again, I'm just proposing another way, looking at the merger, if it would occur, to keep Jacksonville open, and in a sense, the Exeter School District, the new school district, would just have one more building that's currently a part of Antietam. Interestingly enough, that secondary school over in Antietam is partly within the Exeter School District. So I think keeping Jacksonville open and closing the school, the elementary schools in Mount Penn and the Antietam School District would perhaps address the concern that many people have expressed about the quality of the Exeter School District and why you're living here. Another assumption that was in the report was looking at the capacity of the high school if we were to merge and the number of students. Again, that was based on an assumption that the high school capacity in Exeter is 1,550 students. We'd already actually addressed that in an earlier meeting, and it's in the comments that 1,550 is based on the current scheduling process at the high school, where every teacher has their own classroom. So we know that the report shows that on a temporary basis, the school population of the high school might exceed that 1,550 by 70 students. On the other hand, that capacity is open to adjustment. That's something we could look into. Another concern was the population of the enrollment in both districts being combined. Would that lead to overpopulation? We've actually experienced in Exeter several years of declining enrollment, and that has led to several administrative positions being cut and several teaching positions not being filled. And each year we've not filled several teaching positions. So I'm also looking at how a combined enrollment might bring more stability to what we're doing in Exeter rather than the cutting that we've had experienced. And the report also shows how we will experience another decline of several hundred students over the next several years without the merger. So to me, there may be a positive aspect to combining the districts and stabilizing the enrollment in the Exeter district. My final point is looking at the finances. There are a lot of figures there for us to look at. Some people concluded that it would be a financial burden for the districts, especially for Exeter, if we merged. I took another approach and looked at the one figure. In the report that was available publicly, there was the expenditures, the total expenditures for 2016-17, which would hypothetically be the first year that we merged and would be one district. I looked at those expenditures separately for Antietam, for Exeter, and then a merged district. I looked at those expenditures and then divided by the enrollment in the merged district, the enrollment of students just in Antietam, and the enrollment just in Exeter. That figure, and you may argue with whether that's the right way to proceed, but that figure, looking at the expenditures divided by the number of students, if we look at the average cost per student in Exeter in that year versus the average cost of students in a merged district, the merged district, the cost per student would be $550 less than if we were looking at the same expenditures in Exeter. I use that figure and multiply by, the number of students. And my conclusion, we'd save almost $2 million by merging as opposed to going our own way.
You're wrong.
Combined, the cost per student in 2016-17 in a merged district would be $19,710. Just looking at Exeter, the expenditure budget that we were given divided by the number of students would be $20,261. That's a cost saving of $550 per student. And that was just for the first year of the merged district. So in conclusion, I'm looking at some of the assumptions that were made in that report. Certainly the numbers are there, but I think it deserves further examination before I would make a conclusion.
I'm going to take a little different approach. But here we go. First of all, I do want to thank the residents who shared their appreciation for the quality of the education their children are receiving in our school district. It doesn't happen in a vacuum. Our board, over the course of many years, has worked hard to find talented administrators and teachers and support an extensive program of professional development for all. It seems we have been fortunate thus far, and I'm grateful. We asked for our positions for this meeting, and here goes. The funny thing about agendas is the manner in which they drive and control the conversation of the participants. Ironically, most agendas choose finance first, and an entire meeting can be so focused on finance that the rest of the items, which probably reflect the mission and goals of the institution, get lost in the fatigue of the late hour. A totally different outcome would occur if the finance portion were the last item on the agenda. We have presented a financial scenario, and some are calling for a vote. I would urge that we not be so impatient and consider the potential value to all students in a combined school. A little background might help. The Rifton School, and there was controversy over the Rifton School too. The Rifton School has been in operation for a little over a decade. At the time, the board was considering a facility. We envisioned another K-6 building because our elementary enrollment was exploding. We had ready-made families moving in from Philadelphia and King of Prussia. And eventually, we shifted our focus to consider a variety of configurations, and finally, it was the population demographics that ultimately created the 5-6 building you all seem to love, and I love it too. However, more than a grade change occurred. We now looked at the population differently and created a different kind of curriculum to meet the needs, skills, and knowledge that characterized our students and their changing maturity. The high school shift to 9 to 12 from the original 10 to 12 not only offered new curricular and extracurricular experience for our 9th grade students, but was consistent with a high school transcript that is a 9-12 record of coursework. The 7-8 building became less crowded, and the academic and development needs of that age group could be more easily dealt with. In short, we truly changed how we were doing business, and it worked. In 2000, no one would have ever envisioned the school district that we currently have, and that seems genuinely supported by the community at large. In view of this experience, I would suggest that we now focus on a combined school district, how a combined school district could look, to see if indeed we can create something equally appreciated. Concerns over overcrowding are understandable. The transition would not take place instantly. The only reasonable metric for enrollment is a 5-year trend line, which we can estimate and then simply watch what is occurring in the community. The options for student programming are changing given an ever-increasing digital world. The only true message from the job market is that everyone will be shifting jobs and careers. Effective networking is paramount to success. Subcontract and flying around the world will become commonplace, and who knows what else. How we respond to these challenges to ensure our students will be prepared to meet them should be the primary focus of our effort. And yet we may not know with absolute certainty how it will work out, just as we didn't know with absolute certainty when we began planning Rifton, but it did work out. I suggest we now begin to look for strengths and options in a combined district. Really, we have some time, and we should not be impatient. I was hoping for a balance of students, staff, and space that would offer us a fine program and efficient use of our resources. There was a time some years ago when we actually achieved this equilibrium. I think we might be able to do it again. We do not have 200 home developments going up faster than you can believe. Life is different. I'm not suggesting that we ignore the finances. I'm simply recommending we make an equivalent effort to look for the possibilities the merger might offer our students and our community, and I thank you.
Yeah, I would just like to make a couple of comments. First off, for all of you that wrote, thank you very much. Thank you for sharing your opinions. This is probably the most difficult decision that I've had to make while sitting on this board for almost 13 years now, I guess. And I can only tell you that I'm extremely disappointed in one thing that doesn't make any sense to me, and that is that we've talked a lot about what the majority of the community wants, except I'm not sure about what the majority of the community wants. And one of the things that I'm extremely confused about is why this would not be permitted in a referendum form. But it's true, it's not. I've done my homework. I've asked every lawyer that I know to come to sign in on that. And it's true, we can't do a referendum. In a recent conversation with the lead counsel of the Pennsylvania School Boards Association, he did say that we could conduct our own vote, that there are mechanisms for doing that it wouldn't be that hard, that the only thing you would have to do is set up something so that you made sure that only people could only vote once. And at that point, he suggested that, he suggested using your tax ID number from your property tax bill. That would be one way of doing it. I will tell you, I do not view my position as a position where I'm going to sit here and shove it down the throats of this community. I will not do that. I do think that there are values in shared services, and I think there are values in other ways that we can look and hopefully go, and that those things can benefit everybody involved, and yet we can do this without putting our communities, you know, against one another, or we can do this without putting our kids against one another. I think we need to be real careful about what we do.
I want to thank first everyone that has joined us this evening. Also, I'd like to thank anyone here that may have corresponded with me in the last couple weeks. I try to read all of your emails and respond. If I missed anyone, I heartfelt, I would like to apologize for that. In evaluating what was produced through your email, plus through the documents we've seen, I try to look at where we are. I don't look at things as someone with an MBA, I look at things as someone who's an engineer. I analyze things, I break things down, and I call it the spoked wheel, because every process has a piece of it that makes the total wheel. You have the inside hub, you have the outside circle, you have all the pieces that contain it. The biggest hub in the middle is our children and the education we produce at the end. The outside is how we get there. And noting we had positions from children and students and community who were very in favor of us keeping status quo. At the same time, we have others that are, why don't we reach out across the aisle? Why aren't we helping our neighbors? You know, there's merit in both approaches, but you have to look at the bottom line and say, where does this affect the current residents, and where does it affect the current students, as well as the future students and future population? And when you look at that, you look at what do we offer, what does Antietam offer? What do we have, what do they have? And there were comments back and forth that may not have been positive towards Antietam. At the same time, there are sometimes not comments that are positive towards Exeter. But the main thing to look at the bottom line is that every parent, whether you live in Antietam or Exeter, wants the best for the child at the end of the day. I look at the process of a merger as a very radical move. We had a 291-page document, and everyone quickly, it seemed at times, at least on the Antietam side, turned to page 200, which was merger. Whereas there was a page 190, which was do nothing, and in between there was option two and option three, which was shared services and regionalization of the school district. At this time, we do share services with Antietam because we understand that there may not be opportunities for students there due to population, where we allow their students to participate in our sports. And I think that's great. At the same time, I know that we could, and we have possibly offered that if there are students who would like to take our courses, they could. I don't think they've taken that up on us right there. That would be another shared service. I don't know at this time if it's the right time for us to move to a full merger based on the things we've seen. At the same time, I would say it is a time to continue dialogue because I do see the reality of the situation. Exeter Township has the potential of growth. It has the potential of income. Antietam, however, due to its locale, the fact that it's built out, does not have a lot of income generation. Therefore, it's also very limited in its potential for growth for its students and opportunities. It's just a sheer economic thing. If we were to look at the courses offered by Antietam, they actually do mimic what we offer at Exeter, but on a smaller scale, due to just the fact that they have a smaller population. Where you look at it, it's basically you have four times as many students, four times as much tax base. I think that we, if we do go forward any further with the idea of a merger, we'd have to take a very close look at where everyone resides at the end of the game. When we looked at things 2 weeks ago and the first look at where would buildings be closed was almost like we give one, they give one. I don't necessarily agree with that system because not knowing what facilities look like and knowing what opportunities are, I wonder why we do that. First thing identified was the populations inside of the elementary schools where they're using two buildings for the population of less than one. And I wonder why something like that happens because that's unto itself is a cost savings that they should be identifying. And if there's a reason that it's not possible for them to do that because they have limitations in some of the facilities, once again, we are the neighbors. Come and ask us, we can share that. So once again, at this time, I'd just like to thank everyone for coming and joining us this evening. I do not look at a merger as an option I can favor. However, I do encourage our neighbors in Antietam to keep working with us because we do want to help them as much as we would want them to help us.
Peter, Dr. Gore, what do you want to talk?
Well, a couple of weeks ago when we chatted, I gave you my financial analysis and my summation of the report. Nothing has changed. I view the merger as not a financially viable one for the folks here in Exeter, who I represent by the election vote. So at this point in time, for two reasons. One, I can't get over the financial hurdle, but most importantly, by virtue of all the conversations that I've had, all the emails that I've received, I simply cannot support a full merger at this time, but would welcome continuing discussions on shared services. I think that's been expressed.
Good evening. I'd like to thank everybody who showed up tonight. I really appreciate all the communication that we've received over the last couple of weeks. You know, the sad reality of tonight is that this issue really is not about the children. It's not even about education. What it's really about is financing education in a system that is broken. and that in each passing year seems intent on turning out our kids using a cookie cutter process that removes the teacher from teaching. It's not the kids who sit in Harrisburg or Washington, Republican or Democrat, who mess with the funding, who got caught flat-footed on the pension, who passed the unfunded mandates, who instituted standardized testing, and who allowed charter and cyber schools to be paid with tax dollars. The issue here tonight, this merger discussion, is a symptom of a system crying for a fix. For those of you who have been paying attention, Exeter is challenged to be anybody's knight in shining armor. Our budgeted deficits for this school year is $1.8 million. But thanks to a lot of effort and hard work by the administration, the teachers, and the support staff, we've reduced our deficit to about $500,000. Next year, even with tax increases, we are still facing a budget deficit. It's hard to save someone else when you yourself are struggling to keep your head above water. We are forced to fund our schools within a system based on real estate taxes. And the only way to really address rising taxes is to change the system. We also have to pay attention to our own processes, prioritizing our competing budget items in much the same way we make financial decisions in our same households. There's nothing wrong with those who live in Exeter who are opposed to the merger, saying, "I like what we have. I like what we have worked to build." It does not make them small-minded to think and feel that way, nor does it mean they are naive to the consequences of maintaining this gem of a school district in a system that is dysfunctional. I will not sit up here and tell you you don't know what you're talking about. The people I have spoken to come from all walks of life and all professions, and they are all active, vibrant, and thoughtful members who are involved in this community and who make a difference in people's lives every day. They have told me that if you could point to any significant quantifiable benefit, each one to the person would volunteer to lead the parade for a merger. Those who oppose this merger are not hysterical people, as they have been portrayed by some. They do not see Antietam as the enemy. It's just that they have pride, confidence, and passion in what they have had a part in building here. I personally can claim very little credit as the newest board member in Exeter for the success of this district. But many on this board, some of whom, sadly, integrity some folks out there have questioned, which is probably the only thing that sort of irritated me in this whole process, because I've worked with 8 people that are full of integrity and have tried to do the best to do what's right for this school district. But they've worked shoulder to shoulder with this administration, the teachers, and the support staff to create a district that you love and that has ignited the passion in you on this issue. Many people I have spoken to have offered alternatives to begin a gradual process of collaboration. And the nearly 300-page report itself called out 4 options to assist our neighbor. But it seems to me that the only option that the Antietam School District preferred was the full merger. This is now the 3rd or 4th public meeting in which we have reviewed the information on this topic, and things still don't add up. How often must we do the same thing over and over again in the hopes of finding a different result? We need to face the facts that the original criteria on which a merger was to have been built did not withstand the process of due diligence nor the opinion of the body politic. And please don't tell me that 500 people is a vocal minority. And finally, if in this process anyone has gained enemies, and some of us have gained a few, please take comfort in what my hero Winston Churchill said. You have enemies? Good. That means you stood up for something sometime in your life. Thank you.
That's been my position from the start, so. Any public comments?
I would like to, my name is Phil Kaufman, I live at 32 Longview Drive in Exeter. I would like to bring up papers, I apologize, I printed out 9. Basically, what I did is I took the numbers from our business manager that were presented at the last meeting and just wanted to work a few numbers out and go over them with you guys to show how absolutely ridiculous this is financially. So for people in the audience, I'm going to apologize as well, but basically what I did is I took the numbers that were presented in the business case that said that here would be the fund balance of Exeter, here would be the shortfall for that particular year and what the remaining balance is. And based on that number, we would have $4,205,532 in the Exeter Reserve fund balance at the end of 2017 and 18. If you do the same thing for Antietam, they would have $1,187,181. If you add the two together without merging the two districts, you would have $5,392,713. Now, if you take the numbers that were given in that presentation and make one addition, because when the numbers were presented, the one-time merger cost of $742,440, which was the estimate, which I believe is low, was not included in those budget totals. If you include them in those combined numbers, the remaining fund balance at the end of 2017 and 18 will be $4,088,877. To put that in perspective, that's $12,000 less than what Exeter would have if we don't merge. But what's really scary is it's a 24% difference between what the unmerged fund balances would be and what merged balances are. To me, that is a big financial hit. It's not a matter of saying that my taxes aren't going up. The system's broken. It is going up. However, if we take a look at what was proposed and say, can we share services? Why look at just Antietam? Can we share services with Oliver? Can we share services with Boone? Can we share services with Mifflin? Where everybody can gather. In the first discussion, Patricia said about wanting to limit it to St. Lawrence and Exeter. Mr. Quinter, you said that the law says it's the Commonwealth. Let's look at the Commonwealth. Set an example. Don't look at merging. Look at how we can share what everybody does. That will make it better.
Robert Bechtel from Exeter. The two districts that merged in Western Pennsylvania just 5 years ago estimated their merging costs at $1 million. It came out to be $2.7 million. And you can look that up anytime you want.
In the proposal, has anybody looked at or made an assumption of the projected growth for Antietam after this merger? If the merger was to happen, I would expect that it would make Antietam's growth grow. So what is that impact, and will our schools be able to handle that impact of growth in their community?
Antietam does not have the capability of growing unless they start going up on the mountain.
Not true. Not true. Because if the merger will make that a more desired area, therefore homes there will have the ability to sell quicker.
Okay, I understand what you're saying now.
Right? Yeah. So now more families can move in there. And our school districts would have to be able to absorb that flow. So is that part of the projection? Is that being
right now we have excess capability in two buildings, and we would not fill, if you look at the numbers that were put out at the last meeting, none of the other buildings is close to capacity. The only limiting factor so far is the high school. So if there were growth, I would question that it would be so quickly that we couldn't react. The Mount Penn Primary Center is once a high school. There's work being done to name these things, but we don't envision that happening very quickly. So.
I hope that you would take it into consideration and put enough thought into it and the impact.
Yes, ma'am.
Good evening, my name is Brad Ludwig. I live at 1381 Shoffers Road, Birdsboro, Pennsylvania. To the school board members that have recognized that the public has turned out, we have come to you to express our concern, to express our interest in this topic. Thank you for paying attention. This is your responsibility as an elected official. This is a lesson for the children of this school district. How a representative democracy operates. Regardless of the topic at hand, this is how a representative democracy operates. We elect you to serve us. You chose that position. Nobody mandated you into these seats. You chose to sit in these seats and were elected into them in good faith, in honor and integrity, to listen to the people who are your constituents. To the school board members that have chosen, cognitively and willingly chosen, to listen to the people, thank you. To the possibly remaining school board members that are still thinking about this, please consider. We have a representative democracy. This is what our country is founded upon, and I sure hope it can continue. Thank you.
Christopher Riley, 4508 Hilldale Road, Exeter Township. Something you said really caught my attention, Mr. Quinter, is that you would not be opposed to this merger if there was no... What was your exact words again?
My words?
Yes, please.
I said if there were no undue tax impact on the Exeter resident and that there was no negative impact on our academic program.
Okay, which... very good. The only problem with that is there's no way to measure what the impact on the education will be until after the merger. I heard, I believe it was Ms. Kutcher said how Exeter Township has great schools and education. That's because of the not just the teachers, but also the board and the everyone involved in the school district makes this a great district. But with a merger, these are people that did not come, were not picked by Exeter Township. The teachers, the policymakers, everyone was not chosen for Exeter Township. So these, you had no say in where these people came from. So you can't say it will still be, everything will still be as great as it was. Because you can't see what the impact on the education is gonna be until after the merger. Would that be correct?
Every employee in a merged district, be they faculty, support staff, whatever, bus driver, administration, would be working under the same expectations and rules as our staff works now. We have members who we have hired who have had to be put to the wayside. I am sure there might be members of what is now the Antietam staff that would not survive. What I'm saying is you establish the rules, you establish the criteria for being an employee, and then it's enforced. And that is the reason our administration enforcing those rules and enforcing those expectations is what makes this school district what it is today. You know, we can sit up and say we do lots of things. No, we don't do much. We're representing you. We listen to what the school needs or what the district needs, and we try to accommodate them to the best of our abilities. I'm an old stick and rudder man. I fly airplanes. I'm not educated, but I do know that if you establish expectations and enforce those expectations, any weak sisters will be weeded out quickly.
But I mean, even just with the merger alone, you already have enough problems just merging everything together, and now you have to worry about this as another thing. Is everyone up to the expectations that we have in Exeter Township? Is this another burden of things you have to look out for during the whole process?
No, we hire a lot of people every year. Quite frankly, you know, assimilating the Antietam staff would be more than a normal year's hire. But again, they're competent people, they're certificated by the state. They've gone through all the basic stuff. And then what makes a basic teacher excel, and they have some over there that excel, is the expectations of the administration and the leadership the administration gives. And we made it a policy a long time ago when we have a teacher who does not adhere to the policy, just like in your work, I don't know what you do, but if you don't live up to your boss's expectation, you're soon looking for a different job. Or if you're the boss, if you don't live up to your customer's expectations, you're soon looking for another job. So it's
just... I can see your point, but do you understand where I'm coming from? Where you're not hiring a few teachers a year and you're able to keep an eye on and make sure they're living up to the expectations of the township. You're getting Many, I don't know how many teachers would come in.
We've had as many as 30 people hired in a year.
How many?
Or is it correct?
I'm sorry, how many?
30.
30, okay. And how many teachers would come from the Antietam School District?
There's about 80 in there now.
About 80, okay.
So they, we're looking at twice what is possible in a year before. I understand what you're saying, and, but I have enough confidence in the people here, and Antietam's not a bad school. They have their own expectations, they have their own levels of expertise. I've been very pleased to have met some of the teachers, and they got super people too.
I'm not saying,
we always used to say there's that 10% that's worth kicking out. And I don't imagine that would differ too much. Thank you for the question.
Robert Womble, 1122 Stonehenge Drive. First, I want to thank the board for all the great work over the years. It's a lot of time, a lot of effort that you put in, and thank you for that. I want to go back to what you said, Mr. Quinter, about that you would be for the merger as long as there's no negative impact. What about the positive impact for Exeter? I've been trying to keep an open mind, and I still don't see how it's going to get better for Exeter students. And that's the part I've been waiting for.
We have passed. We have, the residents of this township have worked hard since 56, when we first opened a high school, to make our facilities and our staff top rated. They have performed in that way. We have graduated some excellent students. We have a good school system. The people of Exeter Township have always come forward with the money that was necessary to do that. Antietam, before we built that high school, Antietam was our destination for high school. Now, that and a dollar gets a cup of coffee, maybe. But they are in a very similar situation to us. We don't have a big manufacturing base. We don't have anything. Now, what are we going to get out of it? First blush? Not much.
So, that's what I want to know. Why are we doing this?
First blush, I didn't say we were going to gain the world. Well, what will we gain? Our tax base will be expanded. They will pay the same taxes we do.
Yeah, but there's...
Additionally, there... Now, if you listen instead of talking, I'll tell you. My opinion, right? Additionally, because of the initial lowering of taxes, someone earlier stated, won't their property become more attractive? Yes, it will. For every home that's sold, we get a 0.5% money. So if I sell out inside, everything above the Exeter line, we used to get a ton of money every year for construction. That slowed down after we stopped building. So now we have the ability to gain, we've got our tax base, we can get additional monies the sale thing. Now that's not going to last forever. People sell it now. We have not yet seen the monies that the state would give the combined district. I've asked for them. I was hoping to have them by tonight, but I don't know. So I'm waiting for those from the state. So do we have to, if I've got $10 in my pocket, you're my neighbor. Well, you're just a friend, you have to be my neighbor. And you call me up and you say, hey, Bob, can I borrow a tent? When you come over the house, I'm gonna give you $10. Nothing's going to be said about it. We've got the $10 here at Exeter. We've got access. I appreciate your attention. We have excess capability, capacity. We have a good system. And Antietam has people who need greater opportunities. Why should we? If we don't lose money, and if it does not adversely affect our academic program, why should we not?
I only wanted to know what was one benefit for Exeter. I didn't want a dissertation.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Mr. Womble, to address your question regarding what the state might do, I'd like to ask that question of Mr. Diesinger, what his take is regarding the state and funding for education. Mr. Diesinger is a candidate for political office, and one of his platforms is addressing the educational issues within the state, which is critical to the success of any school district. And I just wondered if there was any insight from Mr. Diesinger.
I want to thank Mr. Giappina for the campaign opportunity. That's not really what I'm here about this evening. What I can tell you is I've been in Harrisburg 2 days last week, and we've been looking at the budget and looking at actually, the last revenue figures for the state, they were $100 million short. And that $100 million short actually included an early transfer of $80 million from the profits of the state stores. So this is going to be another tough financial year for the state of Pennsylvania. I think obviously we've talked about it here. The thing that's been promised to us, the thing that needs to be done, is a predictable funding formula for public schools in Pennsylvania. Accompanied by that, we need to reform how we fund public schools. We need to deal with property tax. And the other thing we need to deal with is we need to reform what charter schools and cyber charter schools are doing to public schools. Now, I don't know what the political will in Harrisburg is, but I will tell you, as citizens, we've cried out for new funding, for reform in property taxes, for as long as I can remember. I think at some point, we need to send the right people to Harrisburg to get the job done. And it doesn't make any difference whether they're Democrats or Republicans. They need to have the will to do that. But until we can plan, and we start as a state to reinvest in our young people, you're going to see these problems every year. The hard reality of it is, because of the pension obligations, we can't tax our way out of this no matter what, because the index will not permit us to tax our way out of it. So school districts are on a juggernaut to fiscal ruin. And we need to stop that before it happens. And we need to prioritize young people and the investment in education that will create a highly trained workforce in Pennsylvania that will continue to attract businesses here and will continue to help us with an economic recovery. To get back to what Mr. Giappina asked me, right now, the economic forecast, as far as revenue for the state is concerned, is dismal. And it leads us to other questions. You know, why wouldn't we tax Marcellus Shale? Why wouldn't we have that resource, which is Pennsylvania's resource, help to invest in public schools and take care of the problems that we're facing.
Louise Swartley, 31 Troxel Road. I'm a 41-year resident of this township and in the third generation of grandchildren now attending Exeter School District. So that's my husband, our children, and now my grandchildren. I also volunteered 20 years into the school district, 8 of them in the music department and 12 as a volunteer coach representing swimming for Exeter. With all that said, I'm proud to be an Exeter resident. And I appreciate the due diligence that is the task in front of you. But the bottom line is, I do support children, as my history shows it, and I am for education. But at what cost? I believe education can be done with minimal, and I have to say, as I did email all of you, is it's a tax burden on us that we just can't afford to do. I believe we can educate our children, and at this time, merger is not the answer. No more taxes, please.
Good evening, Exeter Board. How are you tonight? Name's Jason Mell, 401 Pathfinder Drive.
Go perky.
Yeah, I'm very perky. I just want to say my own personal opinion. I am astounded that anyone would still be for this merger from this point. After hearing from everybody in this crowd and at the last meeting, anybody would still be for this merger. I think it's a death sentence at your next election. Okay. Next item. With all due respect, Dr. Bender, I don't know where you got that $2 million from, but I trust the financial guy that's sitting at the end over here. Please check with Dr. Tamora. I want to know where that number came from. And lastly, I counted a majority against the merger, so I guess my next question is, what is preventing a vote from taking place the 15th, next voting meeting?
We still do not have the anticipated revenue from the state, and this board will not make a decision until we have the information.
Okay, thank you.
I'm Joe Pettyjohn from St. Lawrence. I just rose. I had to answer that Marcella Shale. If you tax it, we're going to pay that tax. That's the problem with taxing the Marcella Shale. Now, last week, or 2 weeks ago, I don't know when, I rose to talk about the state classification of buildings. I think they call it the Facilities Condition Index. And all of the buildings in Antietam were failing. And I know Jacksonwald was in Exeter. I was surprised that the high school as low as it was, because it seems to me like that renovation was just done. But then I realized it's more years than I thought. But that was at a 71.5. I'm just wondering, because I was told by business managers that those dollars were not in any of the projections, merging, not merging, jumping to the moon, whatever. There were no dollars there about ongoing repair and maintenance and improvements to the buildings in Exeter and in Antietam. But I'm mostly concerned with Exeter. So do we have numbers? Like, for example, Jacksonwald's number was, I think, 43. Which was in a failing category. My nephew's in the school, he loves it. I went to school there, I love it. I'm just wondering, like, how much is it gonna cost to bring Jacksonwald up to a passing grade?
I guess what my question is, as we all as a board probably questioned, and it wasn't you we were questioning, it was questioning the number, because we have a facilities committee. Excuse me?
This was the state numbers.
Yes, I know. But we have a facilities committee in the board, okay. Exeter does, where we oversee our million-plus square feet of physical plant. We have a facilities director that we then charge with making sure every one of our buildings is operational so we can provide the safest condition possible and the most economical conditions for a building to operate in. When I look at Jacksonville, we have been maintaining it at a very high level. When my wife and I moved in here roughly 21 years ago, it just kind of finished its last wrap to expand it to the current size. We have made sure all our windows are performing at as high level as possible. We know that we don't have any mold issues in the building that I'm aware of. Our HVAC system is working at a very high level. I know we're looking at replacing our roof, but that's common maintenance that you would have even on their house. So if the only number they're basing on is age, I find that to be very challenging, because that would mean that if you'd go over to Italy or to Germany or England, you'd have a lot of decrepit buildings that should be collapsing. So I guess that we question where that number came, because we do invest every year a good portion of dollars in the millions to make sure we can maintain things so we have not let things decay, and that we can protect our investment as a community into what we build so that it can be here for generations in the future if that is to be.
So I guess, just as a follow-up, if I may, so that the budget director, the lady that spoke to respond to
me. Don't be in guidance to my lecture.
Oh, yeah, there you go. Hi. When she said that those figures were not in the budget, so I don't disagree with anything you just said. Are those numbers, like you're talking about a new roof in Jackson, are those dollars then in the budget figures that we've been looking at? Like the new roof at Jacksonville, is that in this budget or no, not yet, because we haven't
put a bid out for it yet? This is guidance without the answer. I only think about the number we talked about last night at our budget meeting.
Sure.
That's my nightmare. I'll let Mrs. Gaius talk about futures.
The Exeter School District prepares a long-range capital project improvement plan, and we have capital reserve, capital project funds set aside to address that. Through 2018-19, et cetera. We have different projects slated, which include roof replacements, HVAC improvements, major operating systems of the school district. I don't know where maybe you can share where you got the ratings, and maybe we could decipher what that means.
They were online. I mean, I don't remember the exact website, but I can get that to you if that would be helpful to you.
Just so that we would know where you're coming from.
Sure.
I would just like to add to that I've been here for 11 years as superintendent, and before that as assistant superintendent for the first 4 years, and I have never once heard of or known of any representative from the state walking through any of our buildings to assess their condition. So I have no idea where they would come up with a numeric rating for the condition of any of our buildings, nor do they track the improvements that we do on an ongoing basis. So that's kind of mysterious to me, how they could even come up with a number. So I'd be curious about that too.
Absolutely.
We've got two funds, a capital fund and a general fund. I'm looking down at our capital fund projections for the next year, and you're looking at, on the average, about $1.5 million a year that we do spend on it.
I'm Jennifer Harvey, 105 Pennsylvania Avenue. I've given you all a lot of emails with a lot of reasons for not being for this merger. I just want to speak to one thing tonight, and those that would be in the audience know I can speak for now. When this plan is in front of us as parents, and you can't give us a positive for our children, of which I had a kindergartner who just started in this district, you scare us half to death. You cannot come to this community and put a plan in front of us that has no positives and only negatives, and expect us to back you, to back the school, to back the taxes for it, and be happy about it. You have got to come to us with a better plan, and it can't be this one. There's so many holes in this, it's like Swiss cheese. You have to come and present an idea that we can get behind you and make it work. This is not it. We want to help. There's not a single person in this room, I guarantee you, that does not want to help their neighbor, that does not want to see these children succeed, but this plan isn't going to get us there. That's the problem. One of the big things that I keep saying, I'm asking the hard questions, I'm making a lot of enemies. I'm not making friends with my opinion. We're not asking the right questions. We want to hold our teachers up and not insult anybody. We don't want to say anybody's a bad teacher. We don't want to say school district's a bad school district, because we don't want to offend anybody. I saw something that really bothered me that said that by asking those questions, I'm not being a good neighbor. I take offense to that. To know that he is excellent at certain things. He's better than some kids at some things. He shines. Some things, you know, he's middle of the line. He's average. He does just as well. Some do better and some do worse. He's just normal, right? And there's some things that, you know what, we got to work on. Teacher comes back and says, hey, we got this and we got to improve it. And I said, dude, we're not doing as well as the other kids. That's life. We are not helping anybody by saying that everything in our school district is perfect, that our teachers are perfect, that our kids are perfect, even that the parents are perfect. We are all making mistakes. If we don't get real about this, we're not going to fix it. There are not equalities between these two districts, and until we face that, so that we can really address the problems and really find the solutions, we're not going to get anywhere.
I'd just like to say one more thing, and I think I sort of talked a little bit about this in the last public meeting. There's a lot of passion in this room for this school district, and I would like to try to make sure that we continue to capture that passion as we move forward. We are involved in a lot of discussions about a number of initiatives. We're in the process right now of putting our budget together for next year. We're talking about the curriculum, the one-to-one computer initiative for incoming freshmen. There's a lot of opportunities for you to get involved. Every meeting that we have, whether it's a regular board voting meeting or a workshop meeting or a committee meeting, you are invited to and you are allowed to participate in. And I believe that we benefit as a board by having your participation, and I would urge you to get involved.
My name is Angela Mulhair. I live on Prestwick Drive. I come here with a couple of different hats on. The first one as a taxpayer, but I think that's been pretty well documented here, what the issues are with that. The second hat that I come wearing is I am a teacher, but not a teacher here. I'm a high school teacher in another neighboring school district. So I think one of the things that concerns me the most for them is the possible and the potential for a class size of increase when you're talking about merging elementary schools two into one, or you're talking about adding 300 or 200 people into a high school. That really concerns me, because when I went to visit Exeter, the high school, a couple of weeks ago, I can't tell you how impressed I was at the high school of the student body and the class sizes and what I saw going on. I spent the entire day there, and I just thought it was incredible. And that coming into that, that's concerning to me, is it putting all of these kids into our buildings as they are. And the third hat that I come wearing is I'm a parent.
of two children at Lorraine Elementary School. One is in third grade and one is in kindergarten. And my third grader struggles. And Lorraine has done, and I can't tell you what an incredible job that principal and those teachers have done for me, my family, and my child. And with a merger, I don't know if she can survive academically and educationally with that type of size that you're talking about. And I know that you had mentioned, Ms. Kutcher, that it would potentially take 5 or 6 years to see the benefits or the drawbacks of a merger. My daughter doesn't have 5 or 6 years. She cannot be. And the amazing staff at Lorraine, I don't know if she could survive it, so I wouldn't be able to keep her in. So that concerns me on those three areas. That's why I'm against the merger.
Just for the record, the average class size at the high school is 20.5 children. The largest class is 30, where it is strictly based upon the fact that it was a class period where more people could get in that class. We don't envision that adding the 300 or 400 would make that much difference.
Hi, good evening, and thank you again for the forum. My name is Kim Farinelli. I live at 91 Burby Road in Birdsboro. I have emailed, and my husband and I have been at majority of the meetings where the merger has been discussed. So it's exciting to have this forum continue to come out. I thank you for your insights, and more importantly, what you would support and not support currently for the community. As a parent, a taxpayer, and a community member, I look forward to participating, as Mr. Giappina said, at future board meetings, as we together continue to invest in our Exeter students and figure out solutions that will work best positively impacting their student achievement. I vote, if I were you, against the full merger. I love that there's other options and solutions out there. I love the fact that most of you are sharing that there is collaborative efforts that we could continue to talk about. And you can count on me to be in seats moving forward to continue those conversations. I think it's, though, time to put a full merger to rest. And the reason being, it's for the sake of our Exeter community and the community from Antietam. As my husband and I and our family, both my retired parents, moved from Antietam, I'm also in Antietam, a Mount Penn graduate in 1987. So I think from a standpoint of both communities, not only students, residents, taxpayers, are kind of at odds. So I think there's a need to make a vote against a full merger and move forward for collaboration. I don't remember who said the definition of insanity of continuing to have conversations expecting different results. What's happening with that is we're not continuing to build a community. Right now, it's tearing apart. So just consider that.
More ability to push out.
It's part of the budget process, and they're just trying to work through the budget process.
So you're just contacting all representatives?
Any last comments from any of the board members? How you doing, Joe?
Fine. I'm probably waiting for you.
Good to see you again.
My name is Jill Skase, and I live at 30 Denver Drive in Exeter Township. My question is, one person came up here and he did make a statement that he's astounded that given the very cogent, compelling, factual content that has been come forward here about why this merger has no cost benefit whatsoever for Exeter Township, helping the students or our tax situation, why anyone would still be voting for it. My question to you, Mr. Quinter, is why do you want this merger?
Jill, I never said I wanted this merger. Have you heard me say, I want this merger, Jill, please?
It's pretty obvious.
Well, I said I am in favor of it if there is no undue tax burden.
But it's been shown that I've been so impressed, Mr. Tamora, is that your last name?
Yes.
Tamora. Intelligent, cogent, compelling, Mr. Lupina, is that your name? Mr. Stout, other comments about this, and all the wonderfully well thought out, rational statements by all the wonderful residents of Exeter that show there's no cost benefit to this. My question is, why would anyone still be considering it?
All I want is an informed opinion. That means I gotta have all the numbers. It adds up. One one's two. Yeah. That's it.
The numbers are in the room. Amen.
And Mrs. Kutcher, you know, I respect your love for the children and for the students and all that. It's all well and good. And as you know, I'm a very liberal, progressive Democrat. And so I'm going to be talking about taxes, and you know we're on the same side on a lot of political issues. That being said, we're a school district. We're not a charitable organization.
Where is the charity point of this? Where
the
is there going to be any charity?
Taking on a township.
No, it's merging.
No,
it's having your assets.
Do they have to bring, as Mr. Tamora made a statement, when you do a merger, you want positive synergies, as is a wonderful word that gets tossed around a bit in the corporate world. You want positive elements to be come for both. I haven't heard one positive reason for doing this merger. That's all we're asking. So my point is that this has nothing to do, I grew up in Pennside, this has nothing to do about the people of Antietam or the residents or their children. This is about the fact, yes, they all want this because this will be a birthday present for them. And I understand that, but we have our own problems. They have no commerce available. We have a commercial corridor that's half empty. So we have our own issues that's been brought up. We have deficits, taxes keep going up. We have become one of the most high millage taxed school districts in Berks County. And that's gonna only bring our property values down. So I just don't see on so many levels this makes no sense. So I've been sitting here, I wasn't even gonna speak, but I can't help, people have tried asking me this question, and I'm not trying to be a smart aleck, I really am trying to understand why You just, you make those points when the points have already been debunked.
Better. And I have to deal with this. I am going to be at every single board meeting until for the next 18 years, and I am exhausted. I don't want to deal with this anymore, and I am sure that you are exhausted. You can't be. I mean, you have to, you know, you have to have feelings about this too. I'm sure you cannot stop beating a dead horse. We've been talking about it for 30 years for a reason, because it hasn't made sense 30 years ago. It's not making sense right now. Vote no and be done with it.
Good evening. I'm Pastor David Duquette from Pennside Presbyterian Church, 25th Street in Mount Penn. I'm a resident of Exeter Township, 112 Ivy Hill Circle. And I still support the merger. The numbers are horrible. As I looked at the trends, and I appreciate and your tremendous work, I looked at the trend for Exeter. I think we started out with a fund balance of a little over 11, and we dropped down to just under 8, and we're down to just over 4. 3, 4, $5 million dropped. That's without merger. Now, 3, 4, 5, I think the next number would be 6. And we're negative. 2019, that's what that trend showed. Antietam's was easier, 3-2-1. The finances, the numbers, the dollars, I recognize that they offer some sort of objectivity as a way to make a decision here. But there is no choice before this group to merge, not merge, nothing that solves this problem. Because it's, and I'm sorry, sir, going to hear anything here on the end. As you pointed out, this is a Harrisburg problem. This is not an Exeter or Antietam or Reading or Daniel Boone District. This is a Harrisburg problem. And so I have a couple of questions that have not been answered. Question number one is the question, Mr. Quinn, that you mentioned that we're still waiting to hear. What will the state do for Exeter? What will it do for Antietam? What will it do for a merged district? Because, friends, that might be the answer to all those dollar questions. Might be. Might not be. We don't know. So that's question number one. And question number two that I wonder about in terms of a merger or not doing something else is in 2019, if those trends hold, and Antietam has zero in their general fund budget, and Exeter has zero or less in its general fund budget, what will the state do? Will we really have a choice? Or will we get something mandated, as happened in West Reading and Wyomissing, as happened in a number of districts back in the 60s and early 70s? I recognize this is not a perfect choice. And it may be the best of a bad set of options. The numbers are terrible. But I don't see that being something that we can change positively. The only thing that will change that comes out of Harrisburg. And what I need to know,
before voting for this or against this, is what will Harrisburg do? Because I would hate to see at the end of the day that we walked away from the best of worst deals. And I would hope and I would encourage you to continue to be patient, continue to wait. Because this is a representative democracy, and if you only had to do what we told you to do, you'd have it easy. But you don't have it that easy. You don't have to do what we tell you to do. You have to do what you think is right.
I appreciate the comments from the pastor, but when it gets to the state of Pennsylvania, I would say past behavior is a prediction of future performance, and so that probably nothing will happen, because there's not the will in the state of Pennsylvania with our state elected officials to address this problem. If anybody sat through our business function meeting last night, where we dealt with putting the budget together for next year, which at this point, even with the tax increase, is running at a deficit. Every school district in Pennsylvania, all 501 school districts, are dealing with the same issue. If our elected officials in Pennsylvania cannot see that there's a problem, then I don't know what they're looking at.
We agree on
that.
My name is Mimi
Leinbach.
I'm at 40 Whitetail Lane. I had absolutely no intention of speaking tonight, and I certainly appreciate all of you board members, your time you've given us, but I want you to, those of you that have not spoken out and given your vote to us, to consider the time you're taking from us. I've got two kids at home. One is sick, throwing up with a fever. My husband is traveling in California. I've been coming to board meetings when I felt compelled to do it over the years. I did it during the Lausch closing. I did it during the possible purchase of the commercial building as an administrative building. And I'm here now. And I think, Mr. Giappina, you had said something at the last meeting, I think it was you, correct me if I'm incorrect, but that when you went through your training, they talked about if people don't come to your meetings, they're giving you the okay, you're doing a great job. Well, there's hundreds of people coming to these meetings right now. And I completely thought the board was correct in telling you that, your teachers, because I never felt compelled to come unless I felt there was something wrong going on. Because I'm home raising my children. And now I've got, like I said, a child at home growing up, my husband's a country away, and I have to sit here for hours listening to the people tell you what we think. So I certainly appreciate those of you that have come out and told us, no, we are listening to you. We appreciate what you are saying. We appreciate that you put us up here to listen to you. And I want to ask those of you who are considering a yes on this to consider the folks and our children that are at home that we are not with. Because really, our job is to raise our children. And we've asked you to build a school district that does that job. So please consider the time we've had to put in. And I really stress the possibility of moving this up. I know, Mr. Quinter, you're still waiting for numbers. We understand that. But please consider all the time these folks are giving up with their families and their children because you're waiting for a piece of paper.
Is sickening. This is sad.
This is what it's about. These kids are what it's about. And you're not looking at all at what the repercussions emotionally and mentally and educationally that this is going to have on them. And I think you're going to be just a side note, I don't know if you're meaning to sound like a bully, but we give you our respect by sitting here and respecting that we have to plead to you. So you need to turn it around and respect us because we're the ones paying the taxes too.
Stronger. You know, I don't envision closing Mount Kent Primary Center, we spent $10 million on it less than 10 years ago. It seems somewhat irresponsible to do that. I envision that if we don't need the space to utilize it for a school that concentrates on the arts and sciences. There isn't just one model that we should be looking at. We should be looking at what are the possibilities. You don't have someone like Steve Jobs or Walt Disney saying, oh, well, you know, we're within that margin of error as far as how much this will cost. Maybe we shouldn't try this idea. I say, you know, this is an opportunity to make us all better, to make a truly unique and wonderful school district.
Mrs. Sellers, can I ask you a question, please?
Yeah.
The proposal that was put together outlined four options, two extreme options. One was the full merger, one was to do nothing, and the other were shared services. I think that a lot of people here on the Exeter School Board have extended their hand to the Antietam School District to do and take a measured approach to do exactly what you're saying to do, but in a way that uses common sense and addresses some of the concerns of the Exeter community. Is that what you're supporting?
I'm supporting whatever option can bring us together in the best way possible.
Thank you.
May I? When I saw
just one person.
Yeah, I know, but
I'm not speaking.
I enjoyed our conversation after the meeting one night and I was talking about landscape architecture and something that's actually a lot more exciting than, well, civil engineering. But
I work with civil engineers.
Excuse me?
I work with civil engineers.
I feel your pain. When I saw the report, frankly, I was excited about the middle. I wasn't excited about do nothing. And I wasn't excited about merger. I looked at regional school systems and said, this is a perfect world. And the reason I looked at that was because when you have children in elementary school, isn't it nice to go to your community school? So the Mount Penn Primary Center, or whichever elementary school the children in Mount Penn and Antietam are going to, they maintain that base. The Exeter children, they're establishing their base. But now let's grow that up to the higher grades, where we say, Exeter right now is exploring STEM. We have the physical amount of students needed to do something like that. And at the same time, we're building this, but what if we created this regional school system where we have this math science-centric program, this arts-centric program, this system where we can bring all elements together and work as a cross-community. And I saw that as unification in a regional school system. And I like that model.
There are really any number of possibilities.
Right.
And you can't just focus on one possibility. There, you know, I look at, you know, immersion of foreign language in the elementary school. You know, whereas, you know, with our small school district, it's nearly impossible to do. But with a larger base, we could.
I think when we look at the word merge, I think that just, it's just too aggressive. But I think when you look at that other word, region, and you consider we are really a big region, I think to me that it has a lot more positive connotation. It also has a positive outfall. Because at that point, if there's concern about the tax base, taxes stay the same. We take that problem off the board immediately. Because at that point, Antietam School District, Antietam School District, Exeter School District, Exeter School District, and we just come in the middle when we're coming to high school. And that, to me, is a place where we come together and we merge our ideas together and we keep our community together, but we don't try to
possibly force an idea into a place that's never going to work, unfortunately.
There is one issue with, I like the idea of whatever works. You know, whatever works to unify our community. There's a logistics issue, there's a legal borders issue. I mean, you know the semantics of it. So, you know, it's one of those things where, you know, if it were to work, it would be a wonderful idea. But I don't know, like, for example, our students were allowed to go to RAC to get similar to what would be an AP class back when my older kids were in high school. And logistically, it was just too difficult to do because with the travel time and everything, they lost too much class time in order to do that. Yeah, if the logistics work out, if something can be worked out legally, financially, I'm open to all ideas. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Colleen Colonio, 223 Constitution Avenue and 326 West 38. I'm paying taxes on two houses in the district right now. I also have two Antietam staff members in my immediate family, and it's already gotten heated, so I'm not looking forward to Easter dinner. Mr. Quinter, you made the analogy of having $10 in your pocket and not wanting to help your neighbor. The problem is you're not playing with the $10 in your pocket. You're playing with the $10 in all of our pockets. Also, the other problem is, I understand helping our neighbors. Like I said, family members in my family who might lose their jobs if a merger happens. I have no problem against the Antietam parents, the Antietam students, the Antietam buildings, or the Antietam district as a whole. But all the kumbaya-ing in the world isn't going to pay our taxes.
Jackie Nowotarski, I'm a senior at Exeter High School. I'll try and keep it short tonight. But Mr. Quinter, I would like to inform you that you said that there were max size of 30 students per class. My first and second period class currently has 33 students in it. And I have a question for the board. This is just a general question. If we were to merge, is there a proposal for a name between these two districts, or will we remain Exeter?
Exeter Township High School, Exeter Township School District.
Okay, thank you. Because I'm extremely proud of where I'm coming from, and since I'm graduating this year, I would like to be able to send my kids to the same school district. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Christina Calabrese, and I live in 33 Sagebrook Drive with my mother, who spoke earlier. And Mr. Quinter, I realize these papers are really important, and I'm a student of international relations. I'm a college student, and I have a minor in political science, and I'm very, everyone understands politics, and I'm just wondering if, you hear the people talking, and you hear our voices, and what we want, and are you waiting for these papers for, control and politics, or is this something that is actually truly, this important to you? Is this a political game
if
everyone's talking and telling everyone?
Young lady, I'm 67 years old. I've had cancer. I got a bad heart. My lungs are bad and my bones are bad. I'm not going anywhere but home. All right?
So yes.
I have no political ambitions.
Okay, I just hope that I hate seeing our government only stand still for so long for something. So to see that happen in my community, it hurts. And I just hope that we can just go forward.
This has been my community since 1946. My great-great-grandfather arrived here in 1712. My grandfather had the first lending library in the township. My father's on the school board for 25 years. I got an investment in Exeter Township also. Thank you.
Well, we got to have
name's Todd Hassel. I live 4721 Painted Sky Road. About 15 years of experience in mergers and acquisitions, just to give you a background of where I'm coming from with my experience. So it's not as though I'm speaking without a little background of what you're going through. Most of mine's been in the Fortune 500 arena, so I can definitely understand the challenges associated with trying to coordinate any type of merger, whether it's a school board or it's a larger organization. Is that better? First off, Mr. Quinter, I gotta give you credit, and the rest of the school board, thank you all for all the effort that you're giving us. You're putting up with a lot of feedback from the community. The community is very passionate about this. And even you, Mr. Quinter, I appreciate the fact that you're standing your ground and not just bucking. I'm hoping you're doing it for the right reasons. I'm hoping you have coming into this with an open mind, because a lot of people here are very concerned about this. My question to you is, this issue, I grew up in Redding. I didn't grow up. I lived here for about 15 years. And even while I was living in Redding, I can remember a time when these two school districts were looking to merge. Working in this arena, I've coordinated the mergers of several large institutions, not, you know, 500-600 people, 10,000-20,000 people. And it begins with the basics. It begins with making sure the fundamentals are addressed on the front end, making sure that payroll systems are synchronized, making sure policies, procedures, workflows, these types of things are established so that not only the community doesn't bear the burden of paying the piper, really, trying to address this all at one time, but the school districts, the employees at school, or the children, also don't deal with the shock of saying, okay, we're gonna force you into this square box now, just because we feel it necessary. I really appreciate the pause that some of you have shown, because trying to push a merger through for political or financial reasons is never really appropriate. It's making sure that if it's going to be done, it's done in a coordinated effort. I'd like to know, since this topic has been discussed so many times, I would assume that these two school boards have started to do this. They've started to merge the policies and procedures, started to synchronize payroll systems so that they're on the same platforms to ease the merger, or even possibly merge the two payroll systems and, God forbid, lay off some of the people in one of the school districts and have the other school district do the payroll process. Whether you do it for one school district or two, really the cost is the same. So what type of efforts have been put into this at this point?
The two districts have remained separate. There's been the coordination of the athletic program. Okay. Other than that, nothing.
So
it's not that it hasn't been discussed. In other words, it's not that.
I appreciate that. I mean, I know that it's been a prolonged discussion. I've only been here for 15 years, and I've heard it enough. To be honest, I'm probably sick of hearing about it with you. So with the discussion out of shared services, and even with the discussion of a merger, are we considering a planned merger? Are we considering we're going to go to vote, stamp the paper, and then tomorrow we're one school district? Are we talking a 10-year progression? Because in the organizations I've seen merge, that's how successful mergers are accomplished. It's not accomplished in an overnight process. It's accomplished by taking the time to make sure that it's done right and in an economically feasible approach.
Well, nobody thought it was going to be an overnight process. We were looking at 3 to 5 years at a minimum.
3 to 5 years?
Just to get.
I would caution you without aggressive of a timeline. Just hearing what you've said now, that payroll systems aren't the same, that your data requirements aren't the same, done for a profession for a very long time. It's a challenging undertaking for a professional who does it for a living, for a school board, even hiring, and God forbid, God help you if you do it, hiring consultants to come in and do it for you. The budgets that you've been talking about are a little unrealistic. I'm not doing that to discredit the accounting that's been provided. I'm just letting you know the feasibility of what you're looking to take on.
Well, there are some of the systems that are the same, just not combined as of the moment.
But even with that, even if you're looking at the same systems, the parameters behind them that operate those systems, the data requirements, the functionality behind them, they all have to be synchronized. So if we talk about the pension, we talk about retirement plans, all these things function differently on different data elements. If they're not coordinated on the front end, I guarantee you, you're going to be putting a significant amount of energy and effort in the back end. What I'm trying to say is, there's no reason that these school districts can't merge. The point is that it doesn't have to happen today. It doesn't have to happen in one shot. This gentleman on the end, I mean, just to try and paraphrase, maybe we're better off trying to eat this elephant one bite at a time rather than we're done today, we're going to put it all together at once. Just for consideration, I hope my time wasn't wasted coming up to speak with you.
Are there any other comments to be shared? If not, I thank you very much. We'll be meeting again next week.